Assalamu alaikum class. Hope you are doing fine. So we are progressing with the maternal and child health, in which we are covering maternal health. And in maternal health, we have covered the components of the reproductive health, antenatal care, natal care, and the postnatal care. So today we are moving towards the Safe Motherhood Initiative. Fine? Okay. So what are the learning outcomes of the lecture today? We have to discuss that what is Safe Motherhood Initiative. And in my last lecture, I have already mentioned that Safe Motherhood Initiative or Safe Motherhood is the most important pillar of the reproductive health package, which has been announced by World Health Organization. We will be discussing that what are different strategies to meet the Safe Motherhood Initiative. We will be discussing the difference between comprehensive obstetrical care and basic obstetrical care. We will be discussing essential obstetrical care, emergency obstetrical care, and pre-delay model in this lecture. Fine. So moving towards the Safe Motherhood Initiative, as I have already mentioned and I have already shown you this picture, that safe motherhood is basically based on four pillars. And this is one of the most important component of the reproductive health. And safe motherhood, I'm sorry. In safe motherhood, the most important component is the antenatal care. And we have discussed in detail that what are the components of the antenatal care, how history should be taken, what are the important components of the examination, what are different investigations which are essential and which lead to the identification of the high-risk pregnancies, and then what are the basic important health education messages which should be given during antenatal care, and what are special important medical conditions which should be identified as soon as we encounter the pregnant ladies. Moving towards the intranatal care. Intranatal care is basically based on provision of the clean and safe delivery services to the pregnant lady. And I have already mentioned 3 C's model, which tells us that WHO says the hands should be clean, the surface should be clean, and the instruments which are used for cord cutting, they should be clean. And we should be taking care of the cord as well. The trained birth attendants and LHPs are authorized to conduct clean and safe deliveries at home. LHPs are also authorized to conduct safe deliveries at the basic health unit. And then if the lady wants, or if there is any complication which arises, then a medical officer is always there. And in case of any other complication which cannot be managed at the basic health unit, they can be referred to those healthcare facilities where the emergency obstetrical care services are provided. Moving towards the postpartum care. The postpartum care is again another important component of the safe motherhood. It includes the identification of the postpartum complications, and the most important ones are the postpartum hemorrhage and the postpartum depressions, sepsis, thrombophlebitis, etc. We have discussed them in detail. The postpartum care should be incorporated with the counseling of the family planning services, because this is the most critical period when we can counsel the couple for the planning of the next baby and spacing them. And the last and the foremost important thing which we will be discussing today is the essential obstetrical care. Essential obstetrical care actually means that all the healthcare services which are essential for a pregnant woman should be provided to that pregnant lady, which includes the healthcare service provision during antenatal time period, during intranatal time period, and during postpartum time period. So these are basically the essential obstetrical services which any pregnant lady can demand, and they should be provided by these services. So moving onwards, as I have already mentioned that Safe Motherhood Initiative has two new pillars have been introduced in Safe Motherhood Initiative, in which the postpartum care has been separated from the family planning. The family planning constitutes an important component of the safe motherhood, and it has a direct relationship with saving the mothers, because it is seen that those females who successively go into a large number of pregnancies and deliver a large number of babies ultimately have a higher chance of having increased mortality. So by implementing this strategy, by introduction of the family planning services, we can reduce the maternal mortality and we can space the number of children which a family can actually take care of. And then another component of post-abortion care has been separated from postpartum care, that it was observed that the post-abortion care should be the same as the postpartum care, but it has been neglected part because majority of the times the females do not get that important component after abortions. So the WHO has recommended to separate this component from the postpartum care. When we look at the basic components of antenatal care, natal care, postnatal care, and the provision of family planning, it means we are targeting to provide the essential obstetrical care to the pregnant ladies. Fine. So this is the basic essential requirement which should be targeting the pregnant ladies for all these three components of the healthcare service provision. When the natal care is associated with the care of the newborn as well, then this essential obstetrical care becomes essential maternal and neonatal care. Fine. So essential maternal and neonatal care is the most important basic requirements which should be given, which are the basic requirements of all the pregnant ladies and those who are passing through childbirth or those who have delivered the babies. Moving outward, but there are certain conditions in which the pregnancy does not follow the physiological process, fine, and it leads to many complications, and there are many associated comorbidities which can complicate the pregnancy and its outcome, which we have discussed in detail in our last lectures. In that part of the healthcare service provision, only the essential component cannot cover the Safe Motherhood Initiative. So another type of healthcare service provision is given to these ladies, which is known as emergency healthcare services. In case of emergency healthcare services, the basic services are enhanced, and now the basic services cannot meet the requirements of these pregnant women. Now some emergency measures should be taken to counteract the comorbidities or other complications which are arising in this physiological phenomena and making it pathological. So the care of services which are provided in emergency are known as MNOC services, means emergency obstetrical and neonatal care services. The neonatal care component is recently introduced, and it's only about 3 years' time that this emergency resuscitation of the newborn and the newborn component has been included in the essential obstetrical care and emergency obstetrical care. Before that time, the terms were EMOC and the EM, essential obstetrical care, EOC. Fine. So for emergency obstetrical care, number one, transport service should be provided, which can be used during the process of referral. And number two, community participation and community communication are very, very important components because it is seen that majority of the times in case of emergency, the community integrates and community participation is important for the transport of the patient, for the financial aid, for emotional support, for social support. So WHO says that community participation and emergency measures of transportation actually help us to attain the emergency obstetrical care services. And then overall, the base is formed by equity for the women, that the women should be empowered and they should be given extra care to attain the safe motherhood. So for emergency obstetrical and neonatal care services, one of the important thing is the referral, that the basic healthcare services cannot provide the emergency services. They are only providing the essential obstetrical care. So this particular lady or the ladies which are requiring emergency services, they should be referred to the higher healthcare facility. Then there should be availability of the transport and there should be involvement of the community participation to attain the emergency obstetrical and neonatal care. Moving towards the comprehensive obstetrical care services, what are essential obstetrical services and what are emergency obstetrical services, by the way? The essential obstetrical services means all the basic services during antenatal period, intranatal period, and the postnatal period means provision of the tetanus toxoid vaccine, provision of the basic tests, history taking, basic examination, any minor ailment, it should be treated, iron supplementation should be given, calcium supplementation should be given, health education should be given. If there is any minor problem, then it should be encountered by giving oral medicine. If any type of sepsis is there, any type of infection is there, then the medical treatment of giving oral antibiotics can be included in the essential obstetrical care. Oral drugs for the treatment of the pregnancy-induced hypertension, not the eclampsia, because eclampsia is never, it's an emergency. It cannot be treated by the essential obstetrical care. It should be referred towards the emergency obstetrical care. So only the drugs for the pregnancy-induced hypertension, if they are given, they basically make the base of the essential obstetrical care. Then any type of manual removal means removal of placenta, episiotomy repair, which comes in the normal process, covers the essential obstetrical care. Moving from the essential obstetrical care to emergency obstetrical care, for example, if there is pregnancy-induced hypertension, is moving towards eclampsia. Okay? And then, for example, the hemorrhages are uncontrolled, and you have to shift this particular patient to a higher healthcare facility where you want to monitor the labor through computer tomography. You think that surgical interventions are required, and this particular lady can end up in some instrumental delivery or cesarean section, and she will be needing anesthesia, she will be needing blood transfusion, she will be needing drugs for intravenous management. And she needs hospitalization, and the emergency obstetrical care services are targeted. So emergency obstetrical care services makes basically the eight major important components. Number one is the intravenous or intramuscular administration of antibiotics, particularly if the infection is uncontrolled and it's moving towards sepsis. Then introduction of the oxytocin drugs through intravenous route or drips, anticonvulsants by the infusions. They cannot be given by the essential obstetrical care. They cannot be given at the basic health unit and rural health center. For all these types of management, the lady needs referral to a higher healthcare facility. It can be the first level where the emergency obstetrical care services are provided, can be a tehsil headquarter hospital, or it can be a district headquarter hospital if she cannot be managed at the tehsil headquarter hospital. Fine, the lady needs admission, she needs continuous monitoring, she needs computer topographic assessment. If she will be needing blood transfusion, then blood transfusions can be given.
Manual removal of placenta is done under emergency obstetrical care services, and it should not be done at the basic health unit and rural health centers or by LHBs. The person should be referred. If there are retained products of conception, they are actually removed through emergency obstetrical care services. Any type of assisted vaginal delivery using forceps or vacuum pumps, etc., comes under the category of emergency obstetrical care. And then, of course, if the planned cesarean section or emergency cesarean section have to be done, it cannot be done at the basic health unit and rural health center. It should be done at the Tehsil Headquarter Hospital, particularly if you have gynecologist there. And if the seat is vacant, or if this particular lady is not present, or the gynecologist is not present, then the case should be referred to the further healthcare facility. Moving towards the emergency obstetrical care, which is EMOC services, the EMOC services are then again divided into basic emergency obstetrical care and comprehensive emergency obstetrical care. The basic emergency obstetrical care comes with the emergency care for women and newborns, in which the intravenous drugs are given, in which the admission is done, in which infusions are given, in which emergency referral through ambulance is required, etc. Comprehensive emergency obstetrical means now the complications are occurring and the assisted vaginal delivery through forceps or vacuum pumps is done, cesarean section is done, or the blood transfusion is needed. So this is the difference between the basic emergency obstetrical care services and the comprehensive emergency obstetrical care services. Moving further, as you can see, the surgeries need anesthesia and the blood transfusion, which are available in the Tehsil Headquarter Hospitals or the District Headquarter Hospitals. They are not available at the basic health centers and the rural health center. So these particular ladies should be referred. Then the manual procedures, vacuum aspiration, retained placenta, they should be done at the hospital. But if there is emergency and the medical officer is available, then removal of retained placenta can be tried at the health center. If there is time constraints and it is considered that the transport of this particular lady can end up in a maternal death or infant death, then instrumental delivery can be tried at the health centers, but the trained medical officer should do this procedure. And then going towards the intravenous antibiotics and intravenous administrations, again, they can be done at both type of services, but in these complicated cases, this is better to refer the patient. Going towards the emergency obstetrical care, what are our needs? Number one, all the trained birth attendants and LHBs and community health workers and local guides, they all should be basically trained to assess the general danger signs. Although the local guides are not trained by the government officials, but certain continued medical education sessions can be arranged for them so they can identify the general danger signs which can appear in these pregnant ladies. But the TBAs, trained birth attendants, and LHBs should be very, very well trained to identify and to comprehend that the emergency is arising and we have to refer this particular lady to for the emergency obstetrical care. Adequate antenatal care, booking of pregnant ladies, regular visits to their homes, their visits to healthcare facility for the antenatal care is very, very important, because with routine antenatal care, we are able to identify the high risk cases which may ultimately be needing emergency obstetrical care. Then social mobilization, it is very important, as I have mentioned, that the community participation is important. And in rural areas and in many settings of the urban area, even it is observed that in case of emergency, the local community arranges for the transport, it arranges for the financial aid, It gives emotional support, it gives social support, it helps the family to decide that emergency obstetrical care services are important. So it is important to socially mobilize the community as well. As I have already mentioned, the training of trained birth attendants is important. A proper system of referral should be established. Every LHV and trained birth attendant or the medical officer which is present in the basic health unit, they should know that in case of emergency, where to refer, how to refer, and to whom they should contact. Risk screening should be done, and all those cases in which the risk assessment is done and they are labeled as high-risk cases, they should be encouraged to move for the childbirth process to the higher healthcare facilities. And the waiting homes actually promote say that all those high-risk cases can be should be staying near the healthcare facility in waiting homes, and in case of any emergency, they can be referred urgently. But the concept of waiting homes in the community is not prevalent in Pakistani setup. So these are basically the important strategies through which we can be able to attain the emergency obstetrical care, which is very, very fundamental to reduce the maternal mortality in Pakistan. So, what are the approaches which can help us to attain safe motherhood? Number one, home visiting. As majority of the community pregnant ladies are in rural area, they are not encouraged to seek the healthcare service provision at the basic health unit and the rural health center. So here comes the role of our community health worker and trained birth attendants and LHVs, that they should go and home visit them. Establishment of the prenatal clinics is important, and in well-established urban population, they are playing their role for the Safe Motherhood Initiative. And WHO recommends that sometime the observation beds can be incorporated in the settings. And we have 8 beds in the rural health center. For example, if during the antenatal visit you are suspecting that this particular lady has high blood pressure and she can ultimately go towards preeclampsia and eclampsia, then you can admit her and observe her. But this facility is not present at the basic health unit. So, moving further, what should be the strategies or approaches to attain safe motherhood during intranatal care? Number one is the promotion of the domiciliary midwifery services. As I have already told you, that training of trained birth attendants is important, training of LHVs is important. Then, in case of any help, the medical advice by the medical officer, that they should be in contact with the medical officer who is working in the basic health unit, that how they can refer the patient, and can they bring the patient to the basic health unit and they can be managed. The concept of maternity home is there. We have some maternity homes in Pakistan which are known as the centers, maternal and child health centers. Their concept is diminishing with time. But yes, the maternity homes are still working, where the adequate service provision to the pregnant lady and the newborn is done. Even in maternity homes, the children under 5 years of age are also catered. Another important approach to attain the safe motherhood is that the safety kits should be provided to trained birth attendants, and monitoring and evaluation should be done regularly, that are they using their safety kits adequately or not, and do they have knowledge about using these safety kits or not. Diagnostic facilities should be there. Ambulance service is very, very important for this critical time period when you will be needing emergency transfer of this particular lady who is having complication, then the ambulance service should be there. And we all know that in rural health center we have ambulance provision in the rural health center, but they are not present in basic health unit. So in smaller communities, the social mobilization is important, where the community plays an important role in providing the adequate transport facilities to these ladies who need emergency obstetrical care. Then postnatal care, home visiting again is important, as I have mentioned that in the first 3 days, the lady and the newborn baby should be visited twice a day,
and then subsequently these visits reduce supply of milk. Actually, Pakistani government does not have that budget, but it is recommended that the for the initial first 1 month, the mother should be given milk supply so she can replenish her calcium resources. She should be given health education about family planning methods. She should be given health education about vaccination of the child, and she should be given about health education about other needs which she wants. And then regular weighing of the baby is important, and then provision of the hospital beds should be there in case of Tehsil headquarter hospital and district headquarter hospital in case of any emergency which arises in the postpartum period or the postnatal period can be handled there. Fine. So these are the approaches to attain the safe motherhood. So what are the strategies to attain the safe motherhood? Again, I am repeating that during antenatal period, you have to give tetanus immunization. You have to improve the access of the pregnant mother to maternity care, that you have to promote the antenatal care service provision. Trained birth attendants should be available in the community. Those who are trained by the government, those who are skilled, those who know their job. Providing a clean environment for birth by giving the safety kits to these trained birth attendants. Establishment of referral centers is important. Emergency obstetrical care and its provision is important at the higher healthcare facilities. Other strategies can be health education, promotion of family planning services, development of standard operating procedures and training of medical doctors in identification of the high-risk cases, and then how to treat and manage them at the lower healthcare facility and a higher healthcare facility. Promotion of intersectoral coordination and community participation are the well understood strategies which we have discussed in our last slides. So moving towards the delays model, that all those approaches are being provided and we are working for maintenance of the Safe Motherhood Initiative. We are working to save the mothers, but still we are having a higher mortality rate in Pakistan, and not in Pakistan, but the other developing countries as well. So why the maternal mortality is really high? Although we have Safe Motherhood Initiative, we have many strategies, because these females, they actually delay their process of seeking the healthcare service provision. Number one is that the females do not decide to seek their care. The second delay is that the help reaches late. Third delay is that adequate help on the healthcare service centers is delayed. And then fourth is that we at the government do not take the responsibility for maternal mortality, and we are taking less initiatives to control this high important indicator of health. Fine. So let's discuss these delays. What are these three delays? Three delays are: number one is delay in seeking care, number two is delay in reaching care, and number three is delay in receiving care. So let's discuss them one by one. So delay in decision to seek care. Why there is delay? Because number one, the women are usually they have low status in the society. Their health is not given that much importance as the health of the earning member of the society. Number two, they do not understand that the complications can arise, and illiteracy and the pressure of the in-laws actually help them to not to understand that the complications are coming and they need medical help at the supervised healthcare facility. And if they have poor experience in their last pregnancy with the doctors and the health centers, then they delay in decision making to seek care. And normally it is a general trend that many females die during the process of childbirth, and even if this female will die, nothing will change. Another important actually an important factor which delays their decision is that they do not want to be a financial burden on the family. So they take delay. They delay the process of seeking care. They do not make decisions in time. And even when we take this delay in decision at the local dai or trained birth attendants part, that they identify the complications in a later part. So that also delays the decision to refer this particular lady to a higher healthcare facility. Then delay in receipt. So class, we were discussing that the females have three types of delays when they want to seek their healthcare service provision during the process of their childbirth. So one is delay in decision to seek care, which we have already discussed, and the second delay is in reaching the care where the transportation is not available or the ambulance is not available, where poor roads are there, infrastructure is not supporting the transportation of the mothers, as we have seen that there are many mothers who live in the northern areas of Pakistan. They cannot reach the healthcare service provision because they are living at the mountainous hills, and it is very difficult to transport them during the childbirth from one top to the area where the doctor is available. So geography, poor roads, infrastructure, availability of the ambulance, and distance to the healthcare center is another delay. And then the third delay is receiving an adequate care. For example, if the pregnant female, after getting the ambulance and the financial aid, reaches at the healthcare center, there the attitude of the health workers is not right, and they are not in a good mood to cater the emergency. There are poor facilities, there is lack of equipment, incubators are not available, or the services for the cesarean section are not available, or the medical staff is not properly trained, or they are not ready to take care of the referred patients, causes another type of delay. So first delay is in her first delay is related to her taking a decision which is late, then a delay in transportation, and then delay in receiving the adequate care after reaching the healthcare facility are basically three delays in the maternal health model. When we look at the statistics, near about 40,000 childbirths per year are without assistance of the skilled personnel, which result in 830 women which die per day. And 99% of these deaths occur in developing countries. And the problems of high maternal mortality are due to the lack of access of the quality care before, during, and after childbirth. That means inappropriate antenatal care, intranatal care, and postnatal care. So, again, going towards the three models, if we target the healthcare service provision by targeting these delays, for example, if the antenatal healthcare service is adequately provided and the high-risk cases are referred to the higher healthcare center even before the childbirth, it will reduce this delay in decision-making. If the women are empowered, their educational status is improved, if their husband and the joint family system is incorporated into making decisions that this particular lady has to be taken to the healthcare facility for the delivery, it reduces this delay. And we have to make it a norm in the society that maternal deaths are unacceptable. So all these measures will reduce this delay if we increase the education of the mothers, if we empower mothers for seeking their healthcare service provision. Then arrangement of transportation and community participation and intersectoral coordination, proper referral will reduce this delay in reaching the care. And even if the females who want to get delivered at home, they should have provision of safe access to the higher healthcare facility. And then the staff definitely should be motivated. It should be trained. There should be proper referral system. There should be proper equipment, supplies, and with a good attitude and the provision of finances will reduce the third type of delay. By targeting all these strategies, which will reduce the delay, we can reduce the maternal mortality. Thank you very much for your concentration. And if you have any questions, I am available and I will answer you in the comment section. Thank you so much.